Hello everyone, welcome to another replay review. This one it will be an axe replay review. I'm gonna stop talking really slowly because that was weird. Specifically, we're talking about Razzy's axe. He, of course, is a patron. This is a replay review done through our February patron special. He specifically noted that he wants me to focus on laning phase, getting zoned, initiation, and fight selection. So we'll be going over everything, but of course we'll take a special note to go through that. First off, good cosmetics. You have lots of particle effects, and it's the key to success when it comes to playing Dota 2. Let's talk about these team comps first. So, we picked Axe. Axe is pretty solid here in most games. There's like some rare occurrences where he'll just get wrecked by a tri-lane. But in general, I think this is a fine pick this game, all things considered. They have a jungler. They have an offlaner who's a Faceless Void, who's going to be up against a duo of Ogre and Sniper, probably, with a rotating Enchantress. Interesting opening. But this is a fine Axe game. I like playing Axe against Juggernaut. It's nice to have something to interrupt a TP, for instance, during Blade Fury. Spirit Breaker, I'm not sure how this pans out, if Axe is good against Spirit Breaker. He's good against Death Prophet because of all the armor, which is nice, and Legion Commander, I think he's also pretty decent against. So altogether, I think this is a fine Axe game. The other big thing with Axe is that you want to play against a lot of melee heroes, and this team has four melee heroes and a Death Prophet who is going to be in the thick of things. So this is a good Axe game. I like it. One of Axe's biggest strengths, of course, is in the laning phase, being able to just abuse people because of the fact that you're tanky, and when they attack you, they'll deal damage. Juggernaut could potentially be a problem just because This is not the play, by the way. Actually, it might be fine. Maybe Blade Dance level 1 is fine. But once he has like 2 or 3 points in Blade Fury, he's really going to be an issue. And obviously I've not watched this game, we don't know how it's going to go, but I can foresee that being, you know, an issue. Your team, by the way, I like Axe with Sniper. Axe Sniper is great. Axe Storm, also very good. I'm a big fan of this team comp. And even Axe Ogre Magi is okay. Like, being bloodlusted and having all this is good. So already, we see you blocked well. He's going to end up pushing the lane because of this. You're not going up, so I don't honestly play a ton of Axe. Obviously, I've played him, and I've played with him plenty. Axe is kind of precarious in the fact that you have to balance being aggressive and taking a bunch of damage, as well as being alive, for lack of a simpler term. So this is all well and good so far. Make sure you get this. Yeah, you're CSing fine. When you realize this pull, what you want to do is you want to walk over there and just at least soak XP. Good, that's what we're doing. We're getting some XP for it. We don't really have the capability to jump into the jungle. Really, I think right now, with this stout and a ring of protection opening, we could be a little more aggressive, in the sense that we have some armor, we know that Juggernaut's only level 2. Spirit Breaker, he's annoying, but he's a Spirit Breaker, and he's stuck in your lane. Like, really, Spirit Breaker should just be ganking mid and killing this guy over and over again. That's the reason why Spirit Breaker is not playing as a lane support. Really, we need to take better advantage of the fact that we can just take a lot of hits. I disagree with Battle Hunger level 2. In general, you don't really have the mana to support spamming it. Okay, good CS. Okay. And you'll be fine here. They're slow. No big deal. They just used a lot for that, too. Once you know Jug has used Blade Fury, that's when you're in a good position to be more aggressive. Like, especially once you're level 3. Okay, good lucky spin. Man. It's actually just one of those heroes where it's like, boy, if I get my spins, he's great. If I don't get my spins, he sucks. Of course, you know, a simple mechanical thing. You want to focus in on lasting under tower. Axe actually has a really good attack animation, which, I mean, I'm sure you noticed during the game. But let's see. Spirit Breaker, he has this stuck on him. I mean, this is interesting as an approach. And I know there are some very good very good Axe players that like really weigh heavily on Battle Hunger in fights. But and just in links. Not only does it do damage, obviously, but it also has the mental aspect of putting pressure on the enemies and forcing them to do something. It also has the aspect where it gives you health. I mean, excuse me, it gives you move speed. I'm sorry, Jesus Christ. So I don't mind this. I still would have probably gone Berserker's Call level 2. I think that's the play in every game. But now you're at the point. Okay, good. I was about to say, this is what you should be doing now. Don't run away. Just tank the creeps. You're tanky. You have 840 health. You have 5 tangos left. You have almost. Well, you have tranquils when you can buy them. Right, he has Blade Fury, but that's okay. Okay, we should be killing this juggernaut. Okay, good. Perfect. Easy. Great. All right. That was perfect. I mean, it wasn't perfect, so let's talk about positioning. It was good, obviously. It was good, just not perfect. Okay. So let's talk positioning. So you're playing Axe, right? You have Call coming on cooldown. You have ample mana to use it. What is the game plan here, right? We know that he's going to spin right away, like ASAP, to get away. Really, what he should have done. Actually, no. Yeah. Well, let's not assume anything on Juggernaut's part, but he's going to spin. And your game plan is to wait for him to spin and then you call him. So what you should have done is called him right there. Honestly, this is obviously going to work out as we've seen. And it's not a huge deal, but in an alternate universe, you know, if he had a TP rotation, oh, that's funny, it says it twice. If he had a TP rotation, then you could have taken a lot of damage, or he could have been saved, or any number of different things. So you want to call him at the first chance, and I understand the thinking. Well, I mean, I assume I understand your thinking in that you want to go farther up so that you can catch him and then not only get the Juggernaut in lane, Juggernaut called, but also Creeps called so that you can get more spins. That's fair, but I feel like the positioning advantage of calling him over here as opposed to over here is just too great to forsake that, unless you absolutely know that, like, oh, creeps are going to be right here or something. So altogether, that was a very good gank by Enchantress, and it was well managed by you, but something to look out for. Okay, this is good. We're not even going to talk about other things. You're not. Yeah. Just going. This is going well. That's really all I'm gonna say about it. This. You're not getting zoned. So typically, one of the good counters to Axe, for example, is just play a bunch of heroes that have dots and have abilities to make it so he can't just tank stuff. Like if you have like a Jakiro Omni Knight duo support with a safe lane Juggernaut, that's very very different matchup wise and lane dynamic wise. You don't need to move so back far back from CS. That's actually a good piece of advice, just to talk about. It's very common to just move around too much. It sounds like such an absurdly simple piece of advice, but if you move around too much, you're gonna miss a lot of last hits. So let's talk about this. We know Juggernaut has mana for Blade Fury. We know he's level 5, you know, whatever. We are level 6. We have mana for a call at least. We didn't need to move back, right? So we move, you know, 6 steps back here for no reason. And then we miss that CS because we have to, instead of just slapping it with our axe, we have to walk all the way over and then hit it with our axe. So you want to be closer to the creeps. Like he's already on his back foot, kind of hiding around. Also, Axe is a very good example of a hero that you really need to be attack clicking on to manipulate creep aggro so that you can win your lane better. So it appears your team is doing well. I know this game wasn't terribly long, but I didn't really look at the score screen, I think, because that can spoil things, I suppose. All right, so let's talk about this. So the decision you have to make on Axe a lot of times is to either go right in for blink once you have like tranquils and like wand and stout, or even just tranquils stout is fine. And or people go straight Vanguard, and then they're just super tanky, but obviously they lack the mobility that a Blink gives. And then obviously you buy one or the other next. You almost always. Sometimes people just go like Blink Force utility, but But yeah, so we just want to keep aggressively positioning. See, like there, for instance. Oh, we'll kill him. Maybe? Maybe not. Ooh, juked. Maybe not. No, we're getting juked. Are we? God, I'm just dazed and confused. This is like the great escape. Oh man, okay. Oh, okay, good. Perfect. I shouldn't say perfect, but that is a fair question mark. The Omni clearly had a plan there. His plan just didn't quite pan out. So that was perfect. And now never mind. I was going to say you could go use Shrine. Yeah, that's what you're going to do. I feel like using Shrine is totally acceptable here, just for the sake of lane dominance. And I would just take this camp, let's say. I mean, if you're in that vicinity, you may as well. It's always hard. It's something we talked about on the show before, and that something that Skrunk does, or did, and many offlaners do, is that if you expend a bunch of resources, you're not going to be able to bully as much as you could before, right? So you had kill potential in that previous fight because you had good mana and you had enough mana to do multiple things. Right now, you're just barely coming up on having enough mana to use one Berserker's Call and one Culling Blade, which is enough in a lot of situations depending on what your bounces are like. But you are you need to make the most of it when you don't have resources, right? You need to play aggressive when you have resources, when you have mana, when you have health. And when you don't have those things, you want to get XP, you want to regen with Tranquil Boots, you want to go take a jungle camp, stuff like that. LC, gonna go buy Naked Blink Dagger, or Blink Dagger Boots. And our farm is going fine, right? 840, how many last hits do we have? We have 26, which is not a lot, but we did get that kill, and we did participate in First Blood. Right now is... Oh my god, excuse me, I got like no sleep last night. Train of thought. Right now the game plan is just to get your blink as fast as humanly possible, right? The blink timing, so we talk about this actually on Sanking, to use a parallel example. These heroes that are drastically different when they have an item, like a Blink Dagger, or like a Shadow Blade on a Slark, for instance, you just have to escalate your farm to the point that you can get that item and then surprise people with it, being like, oh my god, he has Blink at 930, like, oh my god, ridiculous. Again, moving around a little too much. We really don't need to be moving around so much. Also, like, right now, so here's what you can do. I don't know if you're going to call here. You're not going to call here. That'd be a waste of mana. One thing you can do, and this sounds like... Okay, so one thing you can do, and then we'll talk about it after, is you can be here, and just like A-clicking a hero in your lane to get aggro of the creeps, you can A-click this guy all the way down in bottom lane, or whatever your attack button is, and the creeps will still aggro to you. It's just a mechanic thing. It's not a range thing. So if you are just standing here, and obviously you're not getting any spins off, you have full health, you may as well take some damage. So you can just A-click this guy down bottom and get that going. Okay, we should be... Okay, perfect. Blink bottom. Okay. Oh boy, okay. I mean, I would have... whatever. This is fine. Yeah, you don't have a tremendous amount of mana. Okay, that's fine. I'm not going to nitpick. That fight went well. I think you probably could have... Actually, I'm not even going to criticize. That fight was great. It was a good rotation, I think, is the crux of it. Is that your rotation paid off immediately, right? You got Blink Dagger and you immediately made stuff happen. And that's always a concern with... it's always like a tempo thing, right? If you're playing Tidehunter, you want to get good, you want to do work with your first Ravage. If you're playing Enigma, you want to get good damage with your Black Hole. If you're playing Axe, you want to get kills or at least some kind of material gains with the Blink Dagger reveal. That's always a big deal. Blink Dagger reveal is a key moment. Oh man, he's boned. And the Juggernaut just walks up and takes it. Man, I kind of want to play Echo Saber Jug. Anyway, okay. So yeah, that was perfect. That's what you want to do when you're playing Axe. You want to tempo control, and you want to say, okay, I just got Blink. I have a item that I've been waiting for a while, and then you just go get a kill right away. That's the number one priority. So things are going well. All together, like, this game is, you're on the course, so to speak. Okay. Midas, no boots on Enchantress, such as life. I see what you're trying to do here. Well, what is the MMR of this game, by the way? Razzy. Okay, so 2700. Okay, so this seems about right for a high 2K to low 3K game. Alright. So, again, like, sitting around mid like that was fine. I mean, honestly, you were pretty close to getting that kill. I think you maybe could have swung it if you were just played a little more aggressive. On the other hand, they also could have easily TP supported that guy. So, that's fine. I mean, honestly, I don't know why I keep saying that. One of the big things when you are playing a hero like Axe is that if you... Okay, we don't have a TP scroll. We're buying a TP scroll, right? You should have a TP scroll. Okay. Oh, boy. Oh, okay. Sick. Okay, that went well by your teammates, at least. It's a little greedy, but honest. Okay, so here's the thing. When you're playing greedy and you see team fights... Actually, I don't even need to be playing greedy. When you see a team fight going on, right, you have to think of all your possible ways to approach that. This Death Prophet build's terrible, by the way. In case you were wondering. The thing you have to do, and we talk about opportunity cost a lot, and someday I'll make a video on opportunity cost, but I've had some ideas, but not solidified anything. The thing you have to do is you have to weigh the costs and values, right? You didn't rotate to that mid-fight, okay? So, fortunately, your sniper didn't die, and things went fine. Which means, and they had like four heroes in there or something. So that means you have a free lane, right? And that means, also you're an Axe, which, obviously. This is smart, by the way. I'm impressed. So you can either come to that fight, blink in, try to fight, yada yada, you know. Get kills, hopefully, but you're forsaking the opportunity to push top. But the alternative is that, okay, they're all fighting mid. I'm going to get farm top A and push the tower B. So that's two goals that you're accomplishing. And those are very easy to execute goals compared to a team fight, which could easily go either way. Sorry, I want to go back to this fight. Where's our titular? Okay, Razzy. Okay. So let's see exactly how this goes down. Anyway, yeah, like, I mean, you... Alright. We have no wards on the map, which is unfortunate. Actually, that's a lot. We have one ward down. Okay, so you're gonna TP immediately, well, relatively immediately, which is good. This is a great time to... Okay. This is good targeting-wise. LC is a much more achievable kill than... Okay, good. Things are going well. Nice. Okay, perfect. You could have gotten the three-person call if you had just made a little more decisive action right away, but getting the kills, I mean, you still got the kills right away. A little less than ideal, but such is life. Again, what you could have done is you could, like, A-click this guy, and then you'll pull the creeps on you. That's one of those small things that it's really annoying, and it seems like it's not going to do a ton when you're first learning it, but once you have it, like, ingrained in your soul, it's a very valuable thing. Like, just dynamic. The Storm Spirit is very behind and very bad. Oh my god, dude, this Juggernaut. Okay. Okay, good rotation. We tried on that one. Okay, we traded one for one. We traded our mid for their support, but our mid sucks, so that's fine. Unless you're partied with him. Are you partied with him? No, you're not. This is Soul Q. Okay, good. Oh! God, what just happened? Okay, whatever. We'll skip to the part that we're at. Where were we? Da-da-da-da-da. Okay, we didn't see that. Okay. And now let's go a little faster. Ba-ba-ba-ba-ba. Kills top. This is gonna look terrible. Okay. Okay, perfect. That's where we were. Alright, that was a weird hiccup. Okay, this person is walking the absolute wrong direction. This is so incredibly dangerous. Okay, you're re-engaging. This is a very dangerous re-engage, but you can probably pull it off. No, you can't. He's gonna die. I think that's one of those times where you just gotta cut your losses. When we talk about fight selection, that's a pretty good example of a fight that, you know, you tried, but is not a fight you're gonna win. One thing to do, I think I talked about this in a different recent replay review. A lot of times, there is the... you want to do things that are not right. Or I shouldn't say that. So you could have done while you were running away. We talked about this in the Ogre replay review that we just did. When you're running away, what you can do... Actually, this wouldn't even work that well. I was going to say, if you're running away from somebody and they have a blink dagger, you can turn around and battle hunger them and like, yeah, sure, you'll take an auto attack or two, but that'll prevent their blink because they're going to be taking that dot. It's an LC, so that's not really applicable though, so, you know, whatever. Do with that information what you will. Really just shouldn't have re-engaged there. I think, like, I mean, obviously the simplest way to think about Dota is just a numbers game. You had a sniper that's almost dead, so let's count him as, like, a half of a hero. And then you had you had full health and full mana, if I recall correctly. And then the enemy team had three heroes that were all relatively healthy. None of them particularly low, I should say. So then you go into the mental math there and you think, alright, if I go in, what am I going to accomplish? They have three heroes with health. I have one hero with health and one hero that's nearly dead, that's almost certainly dead. And then once you have that math done, what a waste of these. Then once that math is done, that's when you make your decision, right? And clearly, the math was not in your favor, right? Like, 1v3 is just not the thing. So, don't get too caught up in the save-your-friend syndrome. Because it's very easy to, and it's not necessarily the right call. This is a good call, no pun intended. Are we going to be able to kill him? No, not quite. Okay, now we need to circle back around. What is happening? Yeah, see, we separated from our team. And that's not what you want to do. Okay, so let's talk about this again. We'll go back 10 seconds. Okay, so we start the fight right on here. Okay, so we start the fight at a middle point. If we want to visualize a bit, we're starting the fight right here, and we have heroes spread out completely. We have people coming in from this side, from the Dire. You have people way behind you. Well, not way behind you, but behind you on the Radiant. And then we have this guy, unbeknownst to us, on the left-hand side. So we're having a convergence of all these people right in this central point. And they're basically splitting the difference, right? I'm sure there's a military word for this, like a military maneuver. But basically what happened, both because of your choice and because of their play, is you spread out and you went wide, and then they just cut you in the middle, right? They basically, you are discombobulated, to use a nonsense word. You went one way, your team went the other way, your team died for it. That was altogether not a good fight, just in general. But the better play there would have been to say, to not impulsively try to kill Faceless Void. Because not only is it a Faceless Void who's very hard to kill, but you not being able to be the tanky hero in the fight for your team means that your team is just easy to pick apart with heroes like Spirit Breaker and Death Prophet and, of course, Elsie. So, fight selection-wise, that was a good fight. And it was a good start, even though he didn't die. That you kept him out of the fight, at least, a bit. But yeah, you split up too far, so... Something to look out for. Okay, let's go back. Okay. So, we have good items, all things considered. Vanguard Blink Tranquils at 19, and you've actually had it for a little while, is perfectly acceptable and good. Okay, we're coming in, and you're gonna die. Again, this is just a math-wise, it's a bad fight. Like, it's very hard to kill this team in, like, pickoffs, right? So, if we think about axe, there's basically two kinds of axes. Two is an oversimplification. But a lot of times on axe, you have the, you either have the initiator that is trying to be a force to be reckoned with, and then you have the burst axe. And in some games, it's a burst axe game, like if you blink on a storm spirit or a sniper, for instance, and they're low and they have a bunch of creeps around you, you can just kill them. And that's like a burst axe kind of style, right? Where you blink on him, you pop him with a call and a calling blade and a bunch of spins, and then he's done for. But in this game, this team, outside of Death Prophet, and even Death Prophet is maybe not, doesn't fit in that, you're not really great at bursting. What you want to do is you want to be a force to be reckoned with in these fights. And so you want to you want the enemy team to have to deal with you. And that only happens if you're right in the middle of things. So keep that in mind. Let's go back to this. Okay, fast forward, not much happening. Smoke, this is a good time to smoke. We don't have vision to smoke. Generally, the rule of thumb is, hey, let's smoke into a place where we have vision of them. That's just the safe play. And then stuff like this doesn't happen, where you smoke and then you get a whole lot of nothing. And we're going to try this guy. We might be able to kill this guy. He's getting a Battle Fury. All things considered, he's going to have a decent Battle Fury time. This is a perfect blink opportunity. Alright. Perfect. Easily executed. Well done. Altogether. Now you guys can parlay that into a tower. Nice and naturally. Blade Mill next is correct. Alright. I like this positioning. This is smart. This makes a lot of sense. If they try to rotate, that means you can just blink on top of them and stop it real quick. Or if you see somebody like this, that probably wouldn't be too profitable. Unfortunately, this trade's not going great for you because they're going to be able to take your tier 2 while this happens. This is good. Ooh, okay, we just barely undershot that. Ooh, okay. Yeah, we're moving him around a little bit much. Staying together as a team, that's smart. Makes sense. You're gonna die. Oh, wow, okay. You're not gonna die. Huh. Funny how that works. The Spitbreaker should have just charged you. Done any number of things to you. Yeah, actually, maybe he was thinking, oh, he might die from, spins. That's fine. I mean, we're trying to... Yeah, that was fine. I don't even need to talk about that. Okay. So yeah, Blade Mail's next. We're talking about scaling for the entire game. I think, either maybe Blade Mail Force Staff or just, like, Blade Mail Heart, even. Having an early heart is a pretty big deal in Axe. Shiva's Guard would also be nice. You can mitigate the Death Prophet's ult damage with armor, but you cannot mitigate it with damage block. So Vanguard, for instance, gives damage block, which does not apply to things like wards. Actually, I might have worded wards. I'm not sure on that one. But it doesn't apply to the Death Prophet ult, Exorcism Ghosts. So stacking up a bunch of armor is a big deal. Also, of course, armor against Juggernaut's nice. Armor against LC is nice. So yes. All right, boy, I have a ton of messages in Discord right now, but I'm not going to look at those. Hopefully they're not important. Who knows? So they're being very aggressive. We know we have vision of this person, or at least we had vision of this person. Okay, blink up, call, perfect, good, nice and easy. And an easy pick. They're coming to this, but they're probably just going to leave it. Oh, no, never mind. They're going to commit Death Prophet ult. Storm finally has his Bloodstone. Okay. We have Faces Void going on the back lines. You're a little split up, but that's okay. You're not, like, terribly split up. Okay. Ow. Blink is off cooldown. And we probably could have been a little close to that. That was a misplay, but you'll still get this kill at least. Maybe not. Okay, good. Oh my god, why are we not blinking to kill this guy? Okay, we killed him anyway. This jug is just styling. Again, I really think a magic wand, magic stick would be a real game changer here. Okay, good. Nice. Nice, 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 nice. Our Vanguard fairly soon. Yeah, if you had like a magic wand or a magic stick, you just have so much more on-demand mana to go. I've actually even played Soul Ring Axe before, like Tranquil Soul Ring, Blink, etc. And honestly, I think that's pretty cool. I don't think it's necessarily good, but I'm a fan of it. I always have trouble, and it's because I don't play a ton of Axe, but mana management can be something of a task. It's also a game, it's not about our next item. What is your next item? Crimson Guard. Okay, that's fine. Again, the Crimson Guard isn't going to be effective against the Death Prophet Ghost, but I suppose it will help your teammates tank through the Juggernaut and his illusions. So that's fair. People consistently underrate Crimson Guard. Also, Crimson Guard's going to help your high ground a lot when you're high grounding with like Sniper and Enchantress backlining you. Alright, so that next fight got you a lot of stuff. Oh, I always forget to talk about talents. Let's talk about talents. Plus 3 mana regen instead of plus 6 strength. I like that choice. Mana regen makes sense since you don't have any mana regen items. 75 damage or 250 health. I agree with the 75 damage, especially in this instance. I think in games where you were behind, the health could come in handy. But in this game in particular, obviously you're not behind, so you don't really need to have the health. So that damage is good. Where? Okay, I got distracted. Let's get back a little. Okay, where are we positioned? We're in base. Perfect. The safest of all positions. So, let's come out. Okay, we have no ward vision of anything here. Okay. So we're going to TP to Shrine. That's a fine move. We can cut through them if we go till Shrine. Ooh, okay. You just got blinked and Omni Slash. That's what we call the short stick. Yeah, we're just having vision issues. Oh boy, we have the second highest net worth. So your team's just not fighting well. Basically, that's what we're seeing in these long, drawn-out engagements, is that we had one fight where you went the wrong way, we've had other fights where something gets picked off, and then, like, classically, we always say, a death is not an initiation. That's one of the best things Proud has ever elucidated to me. It's one of those things that makes sense, but impulsively, in the heat of the moment, it's very common to just be like, oh boy, We just died. They just spent stuff. Let's use it. Or let's kill him. He should be bloodlusting or sniper, but he's not. I like this Shadow Blade on Death Prophet thing. That's cool to me. Alright. So, personally, we're doing fine. Like, the game is not going ideally overall. That's a good ward. I like that ward. This cosmetic ward's pretty okay, too. I'll give it a pass.
Not one of my favorites.
But it's one that I like. Alright. Yeah, I'm sorry. I was up super late last night for no good reason. So I'm running on fumes. And I gotta record a theorycrafting Thursday after this, so It'll be something. I don't know if we saw that guy, but we should have just blinked and dueled him. Instead, we're gonna get the damage on that guy. So that's fine.
중부 포탑이 공격받고 있습니다.
Alright, again, we're potentially getting split up. Never mind, we're just leaving. That's fine. That was a waste of fortify. I don't know if that was you fortifying, but that was not a good fortify. Alright. What's happening here is that we're doing a whole lot of nothing. We need to farm. Just in general, I mean, obviously you have the highest net worth. Oh no, not anymore. But you have the second highest net worth on your team. But you could be first highest net worth if you just farmed a little more. Like, laning phase went fine. All things it went fine, but it didn't go great. Basically, you could have managed to probably eke out, you know, maybe not double your CS, but you know, 150% of the CS that you got, you probably could have gotten that instead if you played it optimally. Your ability to play Axe is good, clearly, like you have good instincts for the hero. It's just some minor decision-making things, like taking a fight or moving one way when you should move the other way. This is an incredibly ballsy maneuver that is absolute, like, it's a bit much to say that simply. Okay. This is good, we're waiting. Okay, perfect, alright. And we're just gonna kill him. Awesome, that was a great fight. Well, I mean, we walked into that, but that's not the end of the world by any means. Call. Nope, okay. We're a little short on mana. You could have blinked here to run away. Oh, gosh. Yeah, you're dead. So you could have blinked over, like, you could have blinked forward of him, or you could have just blinked away. Obviously, like, this fight's already lost, so you don't want to continue it. And you probably want to start carrying dust at this point with Death Prophet with this
Shadow Blade.
Oh, excuse me. I really am sorry. Alright, let's fast forward a little. Yeah, they're taking a tier 2. That's fine. Losing a tier 2 at 30 minutes, not a big deal. I don't know why you're circling there. I think we're seeing kind of the weakness of our team comp versus the strength of their team comp. Is that they have a bunch of melee heroes that are pretty annoying to deal with, like tanky wise. And they have. And we kind of have a few squishy heroes where, like, if Jug blinks and Omnis, any one of these. Well, if he blinks in Omnis, Enchantress, or Sniper, he just kills them. And even, like, Storm Spirit is going to have issues with it. It's going to force him to use a ton of mana. That was a good return. Unfortunately, you're kind of low. We don't have Dust, so we didn't get to kill Death Prophet. Alright, this is good. Okay, so that was a good way to split up the fight, right? We saw Razzy jump in here on the two-man call, kill one, the other one gets low, and then you chase down the others. This was a doubly good fight, and probably almost the entire reason you guys won it was just off the back of the fact that you guys had the numbers advantage. We saw a lot of fights earlier where we lost because it was a 2v3, or it was a 2v4, or it was a 3v5, yada, yada, yada. But we've turned the tides this time. It's a nice, easy Roche. Oh boy, Stemmer's building a Mask of Madness. Okay, so that was a good call. You guys can take Tier 1 mid now. Very easily. Honestly, I'm amazed that Tier 1 mid is still alive. So I think Heart is the play here. Like, just go straight Heart or Shiva's. One of the two. Would I say Heart? Shiva's is real good. And you do have the damage talent. That's what I'm trying to think, like, trying to compute what the total play would be in. 25 health regen. I wonder, let's see, while we're watching this, I'm going to look it up on Dotabuff. Dotabuff, Axe. Let's look at his win rate on talents. Axe has a... So the 3-mana regen has a 4% higher win rate, which is good. We picked that. The 75 damage has a 2% higher win rate, which we picked that. So we're off to a good start. And a 25% health regen, or 25 health regen, has 1.1% advantage. So, I mean, hey, this is good. Oh boy, that was such a terrible play. Okay, this is good. This call. Oh, never mind. This is fine. Is it fine? No, boy, we're boned. We're freaking dead. We've never been more dead in our entire lives. Oh my god, yeah. So you guys just got rocked. That sucks. That's like the worst case scenario. You guys got like 4 or 5 man chronoed. They had a Death Prophet ult up. You guys are just... You're very dead, to put it lightly. So, I mean, that's just a classic example of a bad fight. We tried... Let's watch the genesis of that fight. Maybe back 10 more seconds. Okay. So, we tried for the pickoff, right? Sniper, he died. He got picked off. But then he was rezzing. So, we made the play to try to go in and hopefully get the Juggernaut and kill him. So this starts off good. The issue is that we all group up here. You know, it was 4 people chrono. The Ogre Magi is off somewhere else entirely. This is like the... Obviously, I mean, it's a Faceless Void, right? That's like the perfect Faceless Void chrono. Like that's the dream. So, honestly... was that the proper play? I mean, I think that was a fine play, axe-wise. I don't think there was necessarily a better play off the top of my head. Like, your team was going to take that fight regardless, it appears, and your... Like, the Faceless Void just got a good chrono. Like, your team kind of bunched up. You probably used too many buybacks here. You probably could have saved one of them. Like, saved Enchantress buyback and just buyback on Sniper and Axe.
Okay, that's a little nitpicky.
Oh man, I cannot wait to go to sleep tonight. Okay, you should live through this. Oh, never mind. Oh, he's gonna come here. Like, you didn't feed dual damage. We needed a ward. Like, we need defensive wards. This is really just an issue in general. I don't think we've ever had wards in this vicinity. Like, this... Boy, I'm sure that looks terrible. This top radiant bounty rune area. Like, we've never had a ward here, never had a ward here, never had a ward over here. And now they're in that aggressive position, and you just bought back, so that was a dieback. That is not good. That is very unfortunate. Man, your Storm Spirit's so bad. Like, he's actually terrible. What is his name? Yemborghini High. Okay. We're dead for 40. Let's fast forward. Let's get to talking about it, Razzy. I don't want to talk about anybody else. Although the bad storm spirit, the bad storm spirit. All right. It's interesting because your team has an axe, obviously, and their team has an LC, and LC and axe fill very similar mechanical roles in the sense that they initiate and they force people to. Oh my god, dude. Is that guy intentionally feeding? Yeah, normally I would disagree with the fact that this guy used retarded as an insult, but he's not wrong. Okay, this is good. One thing I like to do, and I see a lot of people doing, is they keep in the trees over here. Okay, oh, we got silence. Yeah, this is game, right? Okay, that was a fine call. We've kind of like petered out because they just deal too much damage and they're too tanky. And we can't burst them down and we don't have the damage coming out from our teammates to supplement the fact that they are just like styling on us. Oops. Okay, so I mean, as far as Razzy is concerned, he played fine this game, honestly. The things that we really want to impress is just keeping track of fights and keeping track of fights and not losing ourselves by over-focusing, if that makes sense. We had a couple fights, especially like this one top that I think was a real tide turner, where we separated from the pack, and then they just killed your teammates. Your teammates need you around. Like, just look at this team comp. They have three squishy heroes. Granted, Storm's evasive, but this guy's an idiot, so we'll count him as a squishy hero. You have three squishy heroes, and you really and they all need you to supplement their damage. All right, like, they are not good at making damage themselves. They are only good if they have you CCing people so that they can deal damage, right? If they get, like, run up on by a Storm and a Juggernaut and an LC, they're going to have a ton of issues. So, again, fight choice and knowing where to be in fights and not getting overzealous, or a tunnel visioning is actually probably the better term. You don't want a tunnel vision on yourself and think, okay, I really want to kill this faceless void. You want to say, okay, well, my teammates are all dying. I need to help them. So that's a big one. Your itemization was good. I like the skill choices as well. The skill choices went well. And it was really just a lot of these small micro decisions where... Also, you should carry dust. Micro decisions where we just suffered because, you know, we didn't have the proper reaction or the proper maneuvers, etc. Right. And honestly, the other team, they kind of just got a bit too far. Gee. Alright, so this game's over. Hope that was productive. I mean, honestly, like, you played really well, all things considered. Like, the game was rough, but this was a good axe game. I assume, since you sent me, I believe, two different axe replays, like, if you're an axe player, you're doing the right things so far. Yeah, that's about that. I mean, send me any questions you have. If you have specific questions, I think we kind of covered everything we could. Let's just, for the sake of it, go to the score screen if anybody's interested. And your cosmetics are good, and that's what's important. All right. So yeah, the other big thing was that in laning phase, we need to be attack clicking, and we need to abuse the fact that we could be spinning instead of not spinning. Right? So that's one thing just to practice in pubs, even. Like, people think of it as a mid thing. You're like, oh man, I need to fix my equilibrium, but you want to do this in your in every lane, really, and just manipulate the creep wave to be in your favor, whether that means it's killing your range creep or killing or attacking you. So yeah, that's that. Thanks for watching, thanks for being a patron, of course, and goodbye. PM me with any questions.